So, this is going to be Quackaholics Anonymous, episode 14. And I actually wanted to do this one on topic with what I watched last night while it's all still fresh in my mind. It was a film I saw on Amazon.com, and it's called Krisha. I'll put a link to it in the video comments section in case anybody wants to check it out, though I'm going to warn you in advance that it's not exactly uplifting, and it certainly has a downer ending. And for anybody that's been through dealing with unhealthy family members that like to heap guilt on you about your addictive problems, it's probably going to strike you as pretty depressing. I know there were several key components within that film that really hit home to me. And the purpose of this particular video I'm doing, it's going to tie into AA, is the fact that AA, Quackaholics Anonymous, sort of with their amendments process, all they do is dredge up every tiny little infraction that you ever did in your lifetime, and they expect you to feel guilt about it forever and ever. And I've noticed the old timers don't feel guilt about anything. In fact, most of the old timers I knew, particularly that fat pile of shit sponsor that I've talked about often on here, they don't seem to feel any guilt or shame about anything. In fact, they haven't actually changed anything about their life. They're still actively screwing people over and stealing from people and everything else. And I'm going to say that's because addiction is not their problem anyway. Being criminal scumbags was their problem, and they're still criminal scumbags. So when I'm talking about people who are dealing with their past and dealing with things they've done, I'm not talking about low-life bastards like them who are who are utter scum before they were ever even problem drinkers, if they were problem drinkers. I know my sponsor wasn't even a problem drinker. He was just a criminal. And then there's no amount of so-called amends or anything else that those people could ever do anyway, because they're really, truly not sorry for what they did. So when I'm talking about people who have a bad past, and when I'm talking about people who have their addicted past, heaped on them forever, both in society and in AA and all of that, I'm talking about people like the large majority of people who have drinking and drug problems. They're not overall thieves and liars and con artists and all this other stuff that AA tells them it is. Most of them are probably like I am. They were people that just got hooked on the bottle or the drugs or whatever it was, and they just simply couldn't put it down. And the more, the more miserable they became with it, the more that obviously it's not no big mystery, the more you turn to it. And that's what I feel the subject matter was in this film, Krisha. Krisha is a story about an elderly lady who returns to her family on a Thanksgiving weekend. And it's obvious from the get-go that, that her actual past is never told in the film. There's just a lot of blank spaces left open for us to discern what really happened. We know she's been away from her family for a really long time, and we know that she's trying to clean her act up. And I think this is actually going to be like, for her, in her mind, this is going to be the first time she's going to try to reach out to her family and try to begin some kind of process with them that they're obviously not interested in. One reason that I decided to talk about this, not only is it such a personal subject to me, but it's also, it was apparently obvious for all the comments on the film itself, all the critics were a bunch of assholes, kind of like her family are. They were the type of people that seemed to have this attitude. She deserved what happened to her. And, she should have never been allowed to visit her family again, et cetera, et cetera. But I was watching this, and I kind of got an interesting question, both from my own perspective and both from her perspective in this film. In the very beginning of it, she's reaching out, she's apologizing, she's trying to be civil, she's trying to make conversation, and you could tell, obviously, she's uncomfortable because everyone around her is being an utter shit to her, and you could tell she feels that she deserves this kind of treatment. There's a really ugly scene where her brother-in-law is making a conversation with her, and it sounds like he's coming at her from a sympathetic viewpoint, at one point he says, you know, if there's anything personal that you feel that you have to talk about with your addiction, you know, write those things down and, you know, let me read them, you know, et cetera. It sounds like he's being sympathetic, but what he's really doing is he's getting her to open up a little bit, only so he can go and step on all of her vulnerabilities. And he's a real fucking asshole for that. In one point, he's acting like he's heroic because he's tolerated all this stuff over the years. He's acting like he deserves some medal of honor, and that she is way less than he is because she ran away when her addiction got too bad or whatever it is, you know, he was going on about. But I've noticed in everyday society and in some members of my family with the sick dynamics that we have going on, that there are some people who will use whatever has happened to you in your past as a license to treat you any kind of way they want. And halfway through this film, when I was watching it, there was some part of me I just kept wanting to tell her, look, get in your car and leave. You know, the story really rooked me in. It made me really personally involved. It was almost like taking a walk down memory lane with some of those people, you know, and some of the dysfunctional members of my family, you know, in spite of what AA preaches, that it's somehow all your fault, you know, because you made them that way by being an alcoholic, is blatantly false. These people were really twisted long before I was even grown, when I was still a little kid. They were blatantly twisted. You know, it's kind of a funny thing. I don't want to sidetrack here, but I do want to throw this in here real quickly. The people in my family, when I was growing up, that drank, okay, they were the ones that were laid back, non-judgmental, pretty tolerant of, you know, of whatever. It seemed to me like the non-drinkers were almost obsessed with the drinkers, and it seemed like they were far more unhealthy. And some of them to this day still like to hold my past against me. Or it's not really my past in terms of like I did a bunch of bad deeds or something like that. What it is they like to remind me that I was a drunk and I will always be a drunk. And they seem to get a real high off of being able to do that. You know, I was trying to talk to one of them not too long ago, and I just brought up some innocent type of statement about some decision. I said, you know, if I had it to do over again, I probably would have taken that job versus that job. Or whatever, it was something like that, it was something really harmless, and they had to immediately jump back in and say, yeah, but you chose to be a drunk, you know. Fuck you, I don't have to take that. I don't have to take that off anybody today, and that's bringing us back to this film. At one point in the film, you can tell after being shit on all day long by this so-called family, who is no family at all, from my perspective, in spite of... I don't know what the filmmaker wanted to portray with this. I know the what I got from it. She starts hunting around for a bottle. And, of course, she opens the bottle. And, of course, she starts drinking. And then, of course, at one point, she starts popping some pills on top of the drinking. And it really, the whole film explodes with just a really chaotic ending, almost, but it also leaves it ambiguous at the end as to what's really going to happen and what's really going to take place. But it posed a galvanizing question to me that, and I'm pretty sure the filmmaker wasn't trying to get to that point with it. I don't know what he was trying to think. That's one thing I like about art or film or anything else. You come away with your own impression of it, and I don't think there's a right and wrong with it. For instance, a lot of European underground cinema I watch, I did a review for one not too long ago. It was called Secrets of a Soul. And I don't know if my perceptions of the film were correct, if that's what the filmmaker was trying to do. And I don't know that anybody else would see it the way I saw it. But I think that that's how true art is supposed to be. Each person formulates their own perception, their own conclusions. And the one thing that I was left with at the end of Krisha, it has a kind of an ambiguous ending. I won't spoil it if anybody wants to watch it, but I'll say to those of you who are out here listening, if you do want to see it, it's a downer. There's nothing uplifting about it. And, you know, if you're kind of depressive or you're kind of coping with crap from your family right now, I would recommend avoiding it. It's not going to make you feel any better. It didn't make me feel any better, and I'm I've been away from a lot of the clutches of unhealthy family dynamics for a long time. But the interesting question that it posed to me is, did Krisha pick up that bottle halfway through and start drinking on it because what the family said is correct, that, you know, she is a drunk and all drunks go back to their bottle? Or did she, in fact, pick that bottle up and start drinking it because of the way they were treating her, because of what they were telling her, because of the unforgiving attitude of you're always going to be a failure in our eyes, so, you know, whatever. And I don't think many people will grab that because I was looking at the comments and everybody was saying, you know, this is what happens when you show forgiveness and tolerance to drunks. And this is what happens with drug addicts. Drug addicts are the worst people on earth and all their other highly sanctimonious judgmental horse shit that they have no clue what the fuck they're talking about. But it kind of made me think about AA itself, or Quackaholics Anonymous, and my own life experiences with people that are always going to remind you that you're a drunk, with people that's always going to remind you that you have an alcohol problem, with the way the medical industry treats you. I mean, if your doctor ever gets it on record that you ever had a drinking problem, they're pretty much dismissive of you. I know I've visited some medical doctors for certain things in the past 2 years, and, you know, the first thing they want to bring up is, well, you know, or how are you doing with your alcohol, you know? And I wanted to say to one doctor, you know, I have a fucking sinus infection here. I'm sitting over here waking up 3 and 4 times a night, coughing up flame and blowing my nose and my head stopped up, and you're asking me how I'm doing with my fucking drinking. It has nothing to do with any of that. The way that the world looks upon people who have ever had an addiction problem when it becomes public. Now, before any quackaholic wants to get up here and say, well, that's, you know, anonymity, you know, yeah, fuck you. But let me add that AA has actually helped foster that image. You know, all the years I was in AA, whenever we'd go through that whole stupid process of 8 and 9, you know, they would read this one thing out of their fucking book where they're talking about there's a long period of reconstruction ahead. Well, there is no period of reconstruction ahead in AA. In Quackaholics Anonymous, you just sit around for the rest of your life being defined by your past. And, you know, that was another interesting point to this particular film that hit me in a way I hadn't thought about before. I mean, I've thought about it before, but it was almost like it presented an idea that has been in my head, and I'm sure many others as well who have left AA, is that if you're going to let your past define you for the rest of your life, you cannot ever get any better. Now, all this look at your part in it bullshit is just that. It's bullshit. I don't think that you have to necessarily try to analyze, you know, the rather reckless decisions you made when you were drunk or high. And I'm not excusing reckless behavior. I'm not excusing any of that. But I would like to mention that the lady who had gone back to AA from moderation management that killed someone in a DUI accident became friends with the mother of that victim. I'm not saying that's always going to be possible, but, you know, the mother wrote to her when she was in prison. They corresponded, and they got to be close friends. There was some element, you know, I imagine that would have been very awkward. I know that I drove drunk many times, and if I had killed somebody, I'm not sure exactly how I would feel, you know, if their family wrote to me. I mean, that would be a situation that I'm just so glad that I didn't end up in. And I'm not like these quackaholic fuckers that would say, you know, by the grace of God or something like that. It could have just as easily happened to me. It could have just as easily happened to me. And, you know, it's one of those things that I have thought about. I mean, what if it had? I'm just glad it has not. I'm glad that I think I'm past addiction now, and I don't think I'll ever go back to it. I mean, from my perspective, I'm not perpetually diseased like the cult teaches you. But the point being, the unhealthy environment of AA that teaches you that people can treat you like shit and you deserve it because you're a drunk, I think, drags more people down than anything else. I mean, there's obviously nothing positive. There's nothing positive in the reinforcement of Quackaholics Anonymous. I mean, like I was just talking about DUIs, you know, and I was talking about how it worried me, you know, how easily that could have happened. That was all negative. You know, I didn't have anything in AA to counter that. Like today, I can sit here and look at the camera and say, well, you know, I'm not driving drunk and I'm not waking up in the morning to get drunk. Am I blowing my own horn for that? No, it makes me feel better to know that I'm beyond that or past that or whatever. But there's lots of things in my life that I've grown out of, that I've matured past, that I look back on, and they're not all drinking related. They're not all to do with alcoholism. That I made it past, and I don't dwell on those things. I just say, well, you know, I learned something from those things. But there's really no need, in my opinion, to believe that just because you had a problem with drinking and you had a problem with drugging, that that somehow defines you for the rest of your life. And anyone who knew you at that time now has a license to just kick you whenever they feel like it. It was another interesting thing I noticed in Krisha, and I don't know if the director was aware of this or not, but the rest of the family is drinking and getting drunk. The rest of the family's acting like, you know, utter selfish, self-absorbed shitbags, but yet they're all in a panic mode when they find out she had a drink, you know. That's very typical of society in general and typical of people. You know, I know people right now who are getting drunk every night. They've never gotten a DUI or, you know, they've never been arrested. They've never paid any heavy duty consequences for their actions, but they'll turn around and say to me that, you know, when you became a drunk, you chose to become a drunk. And, you know, I can't help but reply right back to them, what the fuck are you? You pass out every fucking night, you know? But it's just a telltale thing that society has fostered, and AA, I think, plays a major role in it. That it's okay to hate people with addiction problems, that it's okay to look down upon them, that it's okay to put marks on their record that haunt them for the rest of their life. And it's an untrue narrative. And some people might say this is a big stretch for me to say that AA plays a role in this, but it does, because you look at the treatment center industry in this country, you look at the way that it's seeped into our nation's undercurrent. I mean, you got people like, and that fucker, that fucking Chris Christie, he's from my home state, I might add, and he's making it, you know, it just pisses me off to no end that he's got this pro 12-step idea about how to run the state of New Jersey. And, you know, I'm even thinking about, I'm not currently living in New Jersey, but I'm thinking about writing him a fucking letter and saying, listen up, you fat fuck, you know, you don't know what you're talking about up here, but you're trusting religious fanatics to run the healthcare system when it comes to addiction, and you're trusting religious fanatics to run the legal system when it comes to addiction. I mean, it's really a poison. It's an insidious poison. And as a result of this insidious poison, there's millions of people out there with drinking problems that want to overcome their drinking problems, that are being taught this unhealthy behavior that you have to, you know, you're scum for the rest of your life, that will end up not getting any better, not really finding any real help for their issues, not moving forward. And yeah, I'm going to say 90% of the blame lies at the doorstep of the fucking AA 12-step treatment center industry. Because if it wasn't for the 12-step treatment center industry, AA would be dead. It is living right now and currently alive because of the court systems, because of the court systems that force people to go there, because of the treatment centers that force people to go there, because of the insurance companies that make people attend 12-step rehab in order to pay for their treatment or anything else. That's why that the popular image of, you know, once a drunk, always a drunk is so popular to everyone. I mean, even among the uninformed that don't know anything about what goes on in the rooms of Quackaholics Anonymous, if you criticize AA in public, they'll be like, well, it helps people though. You know, no idea, no clue, you know, the film itself overall just affected me in so many different levels, that this is the type of society we live in, where all the comments on the film itself, there wasn't one single comment sympathetic to the poor person who had had the addiction that was trying to build the bridges. It was all judgment. It was all glaring, hateful judgment. And then, of course, there were several comments where all these assholes had to jump in and say, well, I'm 25 years sober. I'm like, you know something? I really fucking hate it whenever there's a movie about addiction and some quackaholic has to try to jump in and take the thread over. You know, the other day I was listening to, I was having a retro day the other day. I was listening to some 90s music, and I was listening to one of my favorites. It was called I Am the Highway by Audioslave. And like every other comment is some motherfucker talking about, you know, I was at the bottom when I, when I got to AA and this song was playing, I know that there's nothing you can do about the comments, but it just pisses me off to no end because, you're doing nothing but advertising your fucking cult. And, if you read the whole entire comments through and through, they always end with how holy they are. I have 25 years today by the grace of God. You're probably another old whiner fucking asshole that goes around 13-stepping newcomers and stealing out of the wallets of your sponsees. Anyway, I'm going to post the link to that actual film in the comments section. I know I can include it in the description, but it's just easier and more lazy for me to put it in the comments section. But I'd also be interested in hearing some feedback on this about your own experiences, because I'm one of those people that actually believes that just because you've had an addiction problem in your life and just because you made some reckless choices, it just does not give the people who didn't make those reckless choices and who didn't get addicted the right to tell you that they can piss on you for the rest of your life and you have to like it. In fact, I'm here to advocate cutting ties with people that want to drag you down. People who drag you down are not just people who are addicted. People who drag you down are people that want to heap that guilt on you and keep you saddled into that little box that they want to keep you in for the rest of your life, where anytime you do anything good or anytime you try to break free or rise above anything, they always want to remind you, yeah, but 25 years ago, you got drunk at a Christmas party and passed out in the front yard. Fuck that. I mean, really, seriously. Anyway, I've gone on a talking binge, but this is actually short. It's only at 21 minutes, so I'll see you guys next week. I'm trying to prepare some topics for that recovery house thing, but I'd like to have a lot of information, like facts and statistics, when I do that video. And I haven't forgotten about the other ones, I keep promising. But I saw that last night, and I knew I had to talk about it. So, until next week.